Amy Wilentz.
Thank you for coming, and it's very nice to be here, even in spite of the snow and the rain of yesterday. I'm always happy to have my book plugged, especially by people who've already bought my book. I mean, that's really incredible. I wanted to talk a little bit today about going from fact to fiction, because my first book was a book of nonfiction about the Haitian situation, and it followed the early story of Father Aristide. I don't know if any of you are familiar with this, but now he is the president of Haiti, but when I first knew him, he was a sort of a street priest, and I was lucky enough to meet him then and followed his career up until right before he became president, and that's what the book does. And that was a nonfiction book, but in that book, because I personally cannot get through a book of nonfiction, and I'm still shocked that anyone has really read that whole book and still don't believe them when they say they have. And I always say, well, you know, the really boring chapters are this one and this one. But it's very hard for me to read a whole book of nonfiction. I only read a whole book of nonfiction if I'm forced to review it. And so I wanted to use in that book the methods of fiction and have a narrator and make it move as though it were a real story. And that's what I tried to do there. And in Martyrs Crossing, it was sort of the opposite process. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that today. Basically, I'm a reporter. That's how I think of myself. I don't like the glorified title of author. You know, novelist seems a little uncomfortable since I've only written one. And a reporter walks around looking at real life. I came to Jerusalem because my husband was made the Middle East correspondent for Newsday, which is a paper based on Long Island in New York. And he was Middle East correspondent, meaning that he covered 19 countries from Jerusalem. And I went to Jerusalem. I was pregnant with my third child, 8 months pregnant, and we flew over. And he was off, you know, being a journalist, and I was off being a mother. And I had my baby there in Jerusalem. And 2 weeks after my baby was born, my baby looked very blue to me, and I was disturbed by this. He just looked like he wasn't getting enough oxygen or something. I didn't know. But he was my third baby, so I thought as a professional mother, I could tell he wasn't feeling right. So in the middle of the night, I called my one Israeli friend, because I'd only been there for three weeks or so, and said, you know, my baby doesn't look right. Can you get me to the hospital that's open? I think it was a Saturday, and only one hospital was open. So she managed to guide me to the hospital. She's an older woman who doesn't even drive. She got me to the hospital, and we were sitting at the hospital, and the baby was having x-rays taken, and suddenly all the doctors and nurses gathered around the radio, and Yitzhak Rabin had been shot in Tel Aviv. And my friend, who had managed to get me to this hospital in spite of the fact that she didn't drive and doesn't know the way and can't figure out which street goes which way, had known Rabin in the old days. She had been a member of the Israeli, what can I call it, the Israeli Liberation Forces back in those days before the State of Israel was declared. And she was so horrified, and she said, now everything has changed. And she was right. And peace moved toward war and terror, and everything was upset. And that was my first real engagement with politics in Israel, and my baby was at the middle of it. And I just want to say that because fact informs fiction. And there was my baby, and there was this dead prime minister. Also, I came to Jerusalem because I was following my husband. I came to Jerusalem, and I was working for The New Yorker in New York. Sort of sporadically, I was writing about Haiti. I had really good connections in Haiti, and The New Yorker's editor was a very smart woman at the time, and she knew it. And she used me to get to those sources, and we had a very good relationship on Haiti. And she said, oh, you're going to Jerusalem, great, be my Jerusalem correspondent. So that's the hard, difficult row I had to hoe to become the Jerusalem correspondent for The New Yorker. As I was saying to a class earlier, that's because I was basically free, except for my salary. They didn't have to move me. So I was basically a free correspondent. And they gave me a salary, and I wrote for The New Yorker. And it was fun. But eventually, I had a problem. And the way they first knew that I had a problem was when Robin was killed, my baby was 3 weeks old, and they said, get on the bus of the press corps and go to Robin's funeral. Now, as a journalist, I thought this was a dumb assignment. One, I had a nursing baby. Two, 500 members of the International Press Corps were going to this funeral. Three, it was going to be broadcast live on CNN. I didn't see that my take was going to be really important to world reporting on this event. So I said, no, probably a word that this editor had never heard in her life. And she said, via an intermediary, she said, well, tell her she can just pump and go. So ever since then, pump and go has been a motto. But I did continue writing for The New Yorker for a while after that, and I was also writing political commentary for The Nation and the LA Times. I was still a reporter on site while being a mother. And I have to say that Jerusalem really, it lends itself to fiction. It's a place where the streets are full of stories. There's, first of all, there's the Via Dolorosa, where Christ walked with the cross. So that's a really, really big story. And it's just there in the street for you to walk down that same street. But there are also neighborhoods in West Jerusalem, the Jewish part of Jerusalem. There's the neighborhood of Zionist heroes. There's the neighborhood of Hebrew poets. There's the neighborhood of chapters of the Old Testament. Like, my kids went to school on Prophet Street. And then it gets really sort of recherché. In particular, there's the neighborhood of friends of Israel. And then there's the neighborhood of people who have ever mentioned Jewish people in any way, shape, or form. Like, there's George Eliot Street, because she wrote a book called Daniel Deronda about a Jew. And there are all sorts of, like, you'd have to really think about why it's related to the state of Israel. But they all are. And they all have that sort of fictional flavor to them. It's also not a hard place to find news, as you all know from reading the newspaper. And when I was there, there were suicide bombings. It was much gentler, kinder time. I often feel that my book is somewhat a quaint relic of a sweet time, even though it's about a dead baby and bus bombings. But there were suicide bombings. There were houses of families being razed by the Israeli government. There were babies dying at checkpoints. There were Israeli soldiers being bombarded. It was a very difficult time. And I was not an expert. And this is one of the things that led me to write fiction instead of nonfiction. In Haiti, I was an expert. I was almost an immediate expert at the time because nobody knew about Haiti at the time. It was, I guess it was 1985 when I first started working there, and Duvalier was just leaving. And there were really, you know, no one was interested, and it was a great place to just land and learn a lot and live and be able to write with at least not that much competition. There may have been experts, but they were academic. They weren't daily journalists. And it was a wonderful experience, but I realized the minute I got to the Middle East that it was quite a different situation on the ground. Everybody's an expert. People have lived there forever. Journalists, there's so many foreign journalists there writing in English. I had tons of competition. So one thing I thought was I would write a God book, and that's what I had in my head. A book about, you know, the three gods of Jerusalem. That's how much of a novice I was. I mean, there are about 600 books about the three gods of Jerusalem. But then I had this experience. I stopped working for The New Yorker, and I felt sort of out of the daily reporting thing. Not that I had to do that for The New Yorker, but I felt that I was losing touch with the story on the ground. So I went one day with my husband to a rock-throwing scene at a checkpoint, because I hadn't really seen that, and I wanted to see what that was like. I felt that my reporting was unfinished. I'd been to, you know, a bus bombing. This is how gross and crass it is. I'd been to a bus bombing. Now I wanted to see rock throwing at the checkpoints. So I went, but it was a different scene. And this was the first time this had happened. The Hasmonean Tunnel had been opened by the Israeli government as a tourist attraction next to the Western Wall, but also next to the Dome of the Rock. And the Muslims went crazy. And all the checkpoints were closed because there was rioting. And there I was with my husband, and the baby was at home. And I suddenly felt, what am I doing in this sort of violent scene? I'm being an irresponsible mother. And it was especially frightening because it was the first time that the Palestinians, instead of just throwing stones, shot back at the Israeli army. And journalists have a, you know, when you're covering a situation all the time, you have a good way of dealing with these things. You sort of stand at the sidelines, and the Israelis shoot, and the Palestinians throw stones, and you're away from it. But when the Palestinians start firing from behind you, and they weren't yet any kind of a regular army whatsoever, I mean, they had only had legitimate guns for a little while, it was very scary. You didn't know where they would shoot or what they would shoot or how they would shoot. And then the Israelis came because it was such a bizarre situation with helicopter gunships. And I was there, you know, mom. So I retired to a photocopy shop, which is in the book, I think. And I retired to the photocopy shop with a guy from Oxfam, because he was a human rights reporter. He didn't have to be out there, and he wasn't going to be out there. And a guy from NPR, a radio reporter, who just stuck the microphone out for the noise, he said. And he didn't have to be out there. The photographers and the reporters were out there. And as I was sitting there thinking about my baby, it came back to me all these stories that I had heard from my husband about Palestinian babies at checkpoints and their mothers and how their mothers must have felt. You know, here I was, at least my baby wasn't there, but I shouldn't have been there. And I was thinking how those mothers must have felt being in that situation with their babies, trying to get them through. And that was the sort of genesis of the opening of Martyrs Crossing. And from that point on, my reporting really fed the writing of the fiction, even in little ways. Like Yitzhar's aside, he makes a comment. He's the Israeli officer, and he makes a comment about how he's going to end up, you know, trying to find terrorists in blue-lit refugee camps. And that's from a piece I did, a failed piece I did for The New Yorker on the Palestinian state. And I went to Balada refugee camp, and I was there on and on and on at night, and the fluorescent lights and the markets would come on. And I saw that, and it just, it feeds the detail. The real life feeds the detail. And so did the simple living of life. I was telling students in the other class that I used to go to the American Colony Hotel pool with my children all the time, and that's why there are several scenes at that hotel, which is this incredible hotel in the Arab side. And George Rod, one of the characters, is lying on a lounge chair by the pool watching the cranes rebuild Jerusalem. That's because that's what I did. Of course, I was in my bathing suit with my children, but it's only a little bit different. Having the Eastern European washing machine that doesn't work, the way Marina has the washing machine that has to be kicked to jumpstart it. And also reading other writers on Jerusalem. This is very important. I read Amos Oz, as I was telling the class, and he's such a wonderful and great writer, and you all should read him before you should ever read me. And he wrote a book where he just mentions in passing the lion, the winged lion on the top of the Assuranza Federale building, which is an old Italian insurance building in the middle of Jerusalem. And I went and I looked at it and I thought, oh, good, I can use this. I'll use this lion. And of course, I went farther with it than a really good writer would, but there it is in the middle of my book. And Ari Doron, here's another example of real life feeding fiction. His first name is from Exodus, the hero of Exodus, Leon Uris's famous bestseller about the creation of the State of Israel, is Ari. And his second name, Doron, is a photo chain in Israel. Photo Doron is the name of it. And it's all over the place, and it infested my brain. And so he came out Ari Doron. But also, fiction is fed by the reading of history. And I read a lot of history for this book. And the little character of Gertler is based on stories and gossip about Yitzhak Rabin in his earlier days. And I read Before Their Diaspora by Walid Khalidi. And it's a book that George Rod is always reading throughout my book. And in it, I call it All That Remains. That's another book by the same writer. It's just a better title. And I base a lot of things in the book on the old photos in there. So all these things feed it. But it's also interesting how when you're really into fiction and you're really writing about a place in fiction, that the life in the book tends to imitate the life outside the book. And you discover that things you create actually exist. That's a very reaffirming feeling. There's a table that all the Palestinians sit around in Orient House in my book. And it's one of those beautiful wooden inlaid tables with white patterns on it in the book. And then I happen to go to Orient House, where that scene takes place, to interview a map maker. And on my way in, there was a big meeting room, and I looked in, and there was my table. And that felt very, very good. Or the title of the book. And we had a really hard time coming up with the title of a book. And editors will tell you, just like sort of movie directors, if you can't come up with a title, your book is never going to succeed. You know, if you can't come up with a 3-minute pitch, you can't make the movie. I couldn't come up with a title for this book. And I kept saying to my editor, OK, I'll call it this little phrase from the Bible or that little phrase. And she'd say, no, no. And I would say, well, Hemingway called his The Sun Also Rises. And she said, yes, but you're not Hemingway. And I said, well, you never know. I mean, maybe I could. But she wouldn't buy any of those. So one day, my husband and I were sitting around the dining room table, and really, we had to come up with a title for the book. And I said, how about the bridge or the crossing? Or we had decided checkpoint sounded too much like a thriller and people would be disappointed if you just called it checkpoint, you know, didn't sound right. So he said, well, how about the crossing? And we stuck with the crossing for a while, but it was too deadly dull. Could be anything, anywhere. So then he said to me, how about Martyrs Crossing? Because martyrs, you know how the Palestinians, everybody's a martyr, no matter what's happening. There's always Martyr Street, Martyr Boulevard, the House of the Martyrs. But I said, that's good, and I ran it past my editor, and she liked it. And those of you who are writers here will know that the minute you have a book coming out, even if it's not published yet, you go on Amazon, and you go on Google to see if anyone's saying anything about it, if there's any buzz is the word. So I went onto Google, and I put in Martyrs Crossing. One day, hoping that there would be a review somewhere, a preview. And popped up lots of things, but I noticed they didn't have any reference to me in them. And I called one up, and it turned out that there was actually, in reality, a place called Martyrs Crossing in Gaza, and it was the place where the 12-year-old boy, I don't know if you all read about this or heard about this, 12-year-old Palestinian boy was with his father trying to get across, and there was gunfire, and he hid behind an oil can, and it was videotaped by the French press, and the kid was killed, even though his father was trying to protect him. And that place was called, before the kid was killed, was called Martyrs Crossing. And I was so amazed that we had come up with this title that actually existed in real life. And you feel validated. And then I felt even more validated when 3 days later the Israeli army came in and bulldozed Martyrs Crossing, because I thought that fits in too. The reception of the book has been interesting to me. You know, it's a novel, but of course both sides take it as a work of propaganda. And I gave it to Palestinian and Israeli friends before it was published because I didn't want to be making too many really huge, laughable mistakes. And my Israeli friend who'd been a soldier in the army said to me, well, it's okay. They're never enthusiastic, the Israelis. It's okay. Doron, there's a problem, he said. He does not exist. This soldier does not exist. I guess he could exist, but he does not exist. So I thought to myself, okay, he says he could exist. I'm going to go with it. Because I had no choice at that point. The book was finished. If he said it's absolutely outrageous, I wouldn't have done it. But he said he could exist. So I thought, okay, he could exist. And the Israeli also said, the nurse at the hospital would not give the gun back to the Palestinian family. And I thought that was a good point, but I left it anyway because it worked for my ending. The Palestinians said, Doron is too nice. No Israeli soldiers that nice. In fact, both sides said the same thing. Doron is too nice. So I felt, well, maybe I've hit on some truth somewhere in the book because they both have this, if the opposite sides have the same feeling, maybe there's some truth to it somewhere. But also Israelis feel, those Israelis who bother to read it, which is not many, they feel that something that Amos Oz once said. He said, you know, if I have a badly behaved son and he causes problems, I don't mind saying it myself, but I certainly don't want my neighbor to tell me that my son is badly behaved. And that's how Israelis feel about foreigners and American Jews commenting on how they should behave about their situation. So that response goes right to my heart, and you know, I understand that response. And the Palestinians, their criticism has been, it doesn't show enough of Palestinian pain. Why is the heroine a Palestinian American? That's so we can identify with her, because it's for an American audience, not a Palestinian audience. It's been an exhausting time, of course, because of dealing with this kind of reaction. And also because this is not really the book I wanted to write, as I was telling a class earlier. I wanted to write a small, girlish book with a first-person narrator that's based loosely on my family. And I always said to my husband, this is not the book I wanted to write, this is the book you wanted to write. And he would laugh, because he was the reporter, and it has a lot of reporting in it. And so I would say to him, well, I wanted to write a small book about family and legacy and lost houses and the meaning of real estate and fathers and daughters and integrity. And he would just look at me and say, well, that's the book you have written. So now I feel, you know, maybe I've already written the book I'm meant to write, although I'm now trying to write the small book. So, and I'll take questions.
From your perspective, where you see this going right now?
I would say that I know the Palestinians and I know the Israelis. These are two incredible, fabulous, talented, brilliant people with, you know, unfortunately,
small sections who are really insane and militant and impossible and violent. And in Palestinian society, because of the long occupation, I think, and because of Israeli intransigence, that has unfortunately been allowed to spread out throughout the society, and parents have not tried to stop it. And there's a terrible failure on the part of leadership, especially, but on the part of adults in general, in terms of, you know, trying to see a right path. So it's hard to see a good outcome because the generations are being destroyed. But I still have hope.
What a wonderful way that you used the baby pictures to show that all these people, all these characters were babies at once.
Unfortunately, this is what happens to weak-minded mothers. You look at people and you think, oh my God, this torturer was a baby.
Yes.
Where's his mother? What's she thinking? You know,
right.
You do have that. But I love that part because the photograph is from the book I was describing just a few minutes ago. It's from before their diaspora. And there is a real character, Wa'il Zuwaytir. And he really was a PLO militant. I can't remember if he was part of the terror machine or if he was a spokesman or something. But he was killed in Rome, and I made him a friend of George and Ahmed. And
some of the curse words that you used in the book, could the book have been written without the cursing? And one thing that struck me was the book is written, there's some TV shows on, one called Boomtown, where they have everything is from everybody's perspective.
Mm-hmm.
And are you planning to, besides the book here, do you think about writing? Are you thinking about writing other...
One, curse words. I went through the book. You know, it's easier to do on a computer, and I typed in the little search for the bad word, and I went,
cut out a million of them. So I know just what you're talking about, and I felt, one, you know, here are soldiers, right? And then there are some instances where George uses some strong language, and I felt it was appropriate in those situations. Then the second thing was the narrative points of view. That happened. I thought it was just this brilliant innovation, but now I notice that, like, everybody uses it. It's called a third-person interior. So it's all written he-she, but it could be a first-person narrator, really. And it's fun to do, and I might use it for my next book, which is totally confusing me. And in terms of am I going to write something else, I have two books I want to write. One is the one I was describing. And the other is sort of a foreign consul in Haiti or somewhere, and, you know, a moral and political quandary, like a Graham Greene book.
My least favorite person in the book is Marina, mom. And I'm a mom, but I can't decide why I don't really like her. I never quite got her. And I wondered if any fact developed her.
One reason you might not like her is she let her baby die. I think a lot of mothers look at that and say, you know, just go to the hospital, even if they don't have exactly what you want. Stay home and go to your hospital and maybe it'll be all right. And I can make arguments on both sides of that, obviously. And then she married this guy who's really a problem. And she's sort of a romantic, she's a very flawed person.
I'm a little shocked by the extent of the political spin that was put on news media in your book. You know, the way they had these pictures of terrorists. And I was wondering if you exaggerate that at all, or if it really is like that.
Well, I exaggerated some of it. There are the two pictures of the Ibrahim and of Hassan, right? And the point being the baby terrorist, the grown-up terrorist. That would happen. I don't know if it would be spun by the Israeli army the way I have it happen. It just might happen. I know. You know, it could happen here in the media, I think. Just because it's interesting. Two pictures, they look alike, you know, what is the implication? But the thing, the other thing that I say is, you know, how the news media know things before half the army knows it, because somebody's always leaking to the press, so they're faxing you before the head of the army has even heard the news. The news media is faxed. And that's sort of semi-true. And the other thing I have is Avram Shell, the reporter. That's sort of true, too. There are people in the news media that the army knows are their people. But it wouldn't be a reporter for Haaretz, and that was a mistake in the book. It should have been for Yediot or something more tabloid, because Haaretz is like the left-wing paper that is the New York Times of Israel, or so it believes.
Do you see any chance for theater with this, or with film?
There's always a chance, but I think with so many Palestinian protagonists, it's very unlikely. They're not very popular still, you know. And no one should be popular who continues to have and to countenance a movement where buses are blown up and babies are shot in the face and, you know, settlers are attacked, and even if they shouldn't be where they are, as George says at the beginning of the book. It's just, it's hard to empathize with their movement right now. I certainly don't, and I don't see much of a prospect for this right now, although it's been optioned, but I don't think so.
One thing I noticed in the United States is that it's hard for people to empathize with other countries who are battling something from very little bad that happened here. Mm-hmm. What do you agree with me, and maybe 911 change that to some extent?
Yeah, I mean, I hate to see the silver lining inside of September 11th. So that's a hard one to answer. Yeah. But yes, I think America has traditionally been a nation surrounded by two oceans, with a sort of kindly neighbor to the north and an oppressed neighbor to the south. And, you know, we don't speak foreign languages, we don't travel very much, and it's just a news story what happens in other places. We don't realize that we have an involvement with it. That's what September 11th, I think, brought home, so to speak. Yeah, and you don't want to talk about the troubles in Ireland, no? Because nobody really understands except the Irish American. I think it's true that Americans are isolated. That's why when you say to your editor, I'm writing a book about a baby who dies and her eyes brighten up, you know? And then you say, in Israel. And then her look fades. Or, I'm writing a book about nonfiction about people in prisons and starving in Haiti. It's like, if you want to sell a book, you don't write about foreign places. It's a very hard sell. And that's been difficult, but those things interest me. And I'm lucky enough to have them published, so I shouldn't complain.